Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Wendigos in Washington by Auburn Tempest and Michael Anderle. Narrated by Rachel Dulude. Chapter 1. I can't believe Dylan's house is pink. I'm standing in front of our stone house on the enchanted island of Isilon and giggling at my brother, decorating the lawn of his cutesy-tootsy pink house with white trim. Of my five brothers' personalities, Dylan is the broody, hot-tempered grouch, whose first impulse in every situation is to snark, punch, or diss anyone or anything around him. Somehow, his angel bride convinced him to claim a cotton candy pink house as theirs. Man, I love Eva, I laugh, watching the two interact. Sloan steps in behind me, wraps his arms around my hips, and rests his chin on my head.
A man in love will do anything to put a smile on the face of his female. Your brother loves Eva soul deep.
I smile as that knowledge fills up the well of my emotions. He does. Of the five of them, I worried the most that he might not find someone smart enough or patient enough to see the man behind the scowl and skepticism. Eva is perfect for him. She thinks his moods are cute. Sloane's chest bounces against my back as he chuckles.
I suppose Dylan doesn't seem so bad after serving death for millennia.
I pat his arms where they wrap around my middle. Everything is about perspective.
Oy, it is.
Getting back to our task, he steps away and gathers the string of white lights. Then he gauges the distance to the turret above and poofs up to the roof. Having a wayfarer to help with Christmas lights is the absolute best. I tilt my head back and watch as he holds the wire for the lights in place and uses his power to encourage the ivy clinging to the stone to take hold. When the ivy responds to his call, he works his way down into each crenel and up the next merlin moving across the castle's teeth. I told him he didn't need to be so fussy. If I were up there, I'd string them straight across, but Sloan is a detail guy. It'll be better his way. He works methodically across to the other side of the house. I follow below, connecting the next strand as he moves. When he finishes outlining the unique facade of our island home, he poofs back to me.
How does it look?
Amazeballs. Thank you. He grins.
It's my pleasure, McGraw. Joining in with your family on all the cool holiday traditions is one of the truest joys of my life.
I reach around his hips and hug him close. With anyone else, those words could be lip service or charm. With Sloan, it's all true. He lacked the richness of being in a true, loving family in his childhood. He got the meat and potatoes of an upbringing, but none of the butter and gravy that makes life taste so much better. I push onto my toes to kiss him and send my thanks to the powers that be that Sloan McKenzie is in my life. He might be wound a little tight, but I know his concerns for my well-being come from a place of love. When I step back, he takes my hand and walks me around to our backyard. Crazy enough, it's the backyard from our Toronto home, transplanted. I still can't believe you had Dionysus move our grove here.
You're not upset about it, are you?
Oh, no. I think it's amazing. He wraps an arm around my hips and pulls me against his side.
I failed our fae friends over the past months. I was never home and I neglected their needs. I'm not proud of it.
I pat his stomach with the palm of my hand and lean into him as we walk. You were traveling the world, trying to find a way to cure Raven's curse. I doubt they hold that against you.
No, but even still, once Aiden moved his family and Callum and Kevin moved busy here, they were abandoned. Bringing them here was the only way I could think of to make things right.
You did the best you could in a difficult time. The important thing is that Dionysus was able to transfer the entire grove here and all our creatures are happy. More than happy. Pip told Emmett that the prana power makes them feel incredibly healthy and strong.
Aye, well, I'm glad they're happy.
We quietly stroll along the winding pathways we've worn on the forest floor. The branches twist and twine above our heads, offering homes to our fey friends and several creatures who have immigrated here over the past months. When we get to the other side, my lungs have filled with the restorative strength of the island's power, and I'm steadier on my feet after a long day. I know what you're doing, Hotness. He arches a brow and smiles at me.
Enjoying an afternoon with my bride after 3 months of watching her lay cursed and unconscious.
My heart aches for him over that. I've been there, done that. Don't ever want to do it again. That wasn't what I was talking about, no.
Ugh, you mean embracing our life as a married couple and traditions will pass down to our family in the years to come?
I roll my eyes. He sees me coming a mile away and is way too smart to be playing this dumb. You think you're cute, don't you? His mouth curls in a coy smile.
A wee bit charming, if nothing else.
I know you're worried about me, but I'm fine. Yes, Raven possessed me and cursed me. Yes, it was dodgy there for a while. I'm better now. I'm here. I'm conscious, and I can't stay tucked away on this enchanted island forever, no matter how perfect you make our lives here seem. He sighs.
All I'm asking is that you stay here until Bruin gets back and we get word that Raven and Coyote have been taken care of.
Bruin and Artemis have been on the hunt for months. It might take months more to find them, if they find them. I can't stay here and hide. He kisses my forehead and presses his finger over my lips.
You've been awake for 4 days, that's it. You're still weak. Bruin hasn't come back yet, and it's the holidays. Let's stay in the moment for the next week and enjoy ourselves over Yule and Christmas. Then we can see where we are and talk about next steps.
I hear what he's saying, but please, love,
I need this. I need to shut out the world for a while until I get myself back onto a solid foundation again.
I sigh and take his hands in mine. I get that you're scared and that what happened is still fresh, but I'm fine. Please don't wrap me in cotton.
I'm trying, Fee. Honestly, I am. But when I look at you, I still see you collapsing in front of me when that bitch poisoned you and left you for dead.
I waggle my brows and smile. Well then, all I need to do is fill your mind with some new mental imagery that paints a better picture. He chuckles.
I'm not sure that's possible.
Challenge accepted. Answering an invite from Brenny and Emmett, Sloan poofs us up to the cool condo on the top floor of the Palace of the Hidden City. Elvis's Blue Christmas is playing, and my brothers are singing, baking, and generally making fools of themselves. Good times. What's happening here? I scan the candy chaos strewn across the table. Jackson and Meg look up. Icing and colored sprinkles cover their faces.
We're baking Christmas cookies,
Meg announces. Jackson nods.
Ireland is cranky, so Mommy said she couldn't make cookies.
But she promised,
Meg continues.
Yeah, she promised.
The disappointment in Jackson's tone tugs on my heartstrings. It's hard for them not to have Kinu's attention after so many years of being the center of her world. The twins take up so much of her time and effort that even though Aiden and Kinu try not to let Meg and Jackson get left behind, it happens. Brenny is rolling out sugar cookie dough like a pro and arches a brow at him.
We already went over that, right, Jax?
Jackson nods again.
I know. Sometimes promises change and we can't get mad because it's nobody's fault. Being cool about it is part of being more grown up.
I wash my hands in the little sink at the island and grab a hand towel before walking over to join them. That's right. Sometimes what we want to do and what we're able to do aren't always the same. Sometimes things happen and we must be understanding. Jackson seems to understand, but Maggie is 4, so she's more interested in eating gumdrops and the fact that her fingers are sticking together.
Will you decorate cookies with us, Uncle Sloan?
She asks. The question lights him up.
I'd love nothing better, lass. Let me wash up and we'll see what we can come up with using our creative muse.
Emmett laughs beside me. He does realize she's 4, right? I grin. He does, but insists speaking to the kids as he would a peer enhances their understanding of language and situational context. He said his parents never spoke to him like he was a child, and look how smart he is. Em's brows arch.
Well, it's hard to argue that.
Right? Sloan returns from washing his hands and grabs the hand towel I'm hugging.
No, let's see what we have to work with, little one.
I straighten the selection of icing tubes, the little containers of sprinkles, and the bowls of gumdrops, mini chocolate chips, and silver sugar balls. Keanu sent everything we need. The elevator door opens, and Dylan and Eva come out in front of Callum, Kevin, and Busy. Dylan claps his hands and holds his fists over his head.
Let the cookie decorating competition begin.
I snort. Why does it have to be a competition? He pegs me with a look.
How else can I beat you and reign supreme?
There's that. Eva giggles and joins the queue to wash up.
Never have I ever decorated a cookie.
My mouth drops open.
You're kidding.
Eva's been using the never have I ever theme to tell us when she's trying something new and exciting. It started in Texas in September when we played it during our Riverwalk dinner cruise.
Nope, this is a new one for me.
Don't angels have cookies?
Callum asks.
No, but we eat a lot of fluffy cake. It's in the name.
Her expectant gaze has me giggling as I follow her meaning.
Ah, angel food cake.
Her triumphant grin is amazing.
Although, we just call it cake.
By the look on everyone's face, I'm not the only one wondering if she's serious. When she bursts into a fit of laughter, I roll my eyes and laugh with her. Her teasing and sarcasm are coming along.
That was a good one. You got me.
Dylan laughs too.
Good one, babe. So how did the afternoon of holiday lighting go?
Emmett brings over another pan of baked sugar cookies to decorate.
It went well. Are you too sure you don't want to claim a house on our cobbled court?
Emmett grins.
I've got my eye on the sage green one with the skylights diagonally across from you. If things work out as I hope, maybe we'll be neighbors.
That lights me up.
Really?
What things are in flux? How can I help?
He bites the pointed tip of a star cookie and grins.
Nothing to be done. All the things have been set in motion, and I'm waiting for the outcome to present itself.
That's very cryptic. He shakes his head.
Patience, sasshopper.
I laugh. Not my best event.
Really? I'm shocked.
The idea that Emmett might claim the house across the road fills me with a warm rush of holiday cheer. I know he's been missing the feeling of home and family since he and Brenny... I glance around the massive condo. Crappers. The boys put a lot of time and energy into remodeling this penthouse in the hopes that we'd all move in here. As much as I loved the gesture, we've all got our own lives and routines. Sloan wasn't keen to live like fraternity brothers forever, and I admit, I prefer us all having our own spaces to build our lives. But you just finished renovating this place, I say.
Brenny opens the oven door and slides in the next pan of cookies. It's all good. I'm not walking away from this place now that it's super cool. Besides, I might have some plans of my own.
Before I can question him, the elevator doors open again, and Aiden comes in, carrying Kara.
We've come to cookie.
He tosses his toddler into the air, and her long, russet hair flutters behind her as she squeals. I laugh, drawing a green happy face on my snowman.
To cookie? I love that you made it into a verb.
Aiden grabs one of the high chairs from against the wall and straps the baby in.
In our world, anything can be a verb.
True story.
Aiden sets Kara up with one of the yet-to-be-decorated cookies and leaves her to chew on it while he checks on Meg and Jackson.
Wow! Those are some spectacular cookies, kids.
Yeah, we know,
Jackson agrees.
Uncle Sloan said they were inspired.
Aiden chuckles.
Uncle Sloan is right. These are inspirational cookies.
Oh, you have angels.
Eva picks one of the lady cookies with wings and a triangle dress.
I'm going to decorate this one.
Dylan grins.
And I'm going to eat it. I love eating.
Aiden backhands Dylan.
Don't be rude.
Warm cookies.
Dylan rolls his eyes.
Geez, what did you think I was going to say? Get your mind out of the gutter, brother. You already have four kids. I think it's you who has a one-track mind.
Behind the kids' heads, Aiden holds up a middle finger salute.
You wait. When you've got little ones running around, I'm going to remember this and corrupt them.
At the mention of babies, Dylan looks at Eva, and the way she's smiling at him, I know immediately.
Oh my goodness, you're pregnant.
Dylan looks at me and makes a face.
I never said that. You're nuts.
I laugh. My level of cracked has nothing to do with it. I'm perceptive, and I saw that gushy, pining look the two of you shared at the mention of your impending babies.
So what? We want kids.
I shake my head, surer than ever, as I study their reactions. Nope, it wasn't a longing. I can't wait until we have babies look. It was a this baby is going to be amazing and so freaking loved look. Dylan looks at me and scowls. He holds a stern look of disapproval, then curses and shrugs.
Okay, fine. We have news, but we were going to announce it at the family celebration tomorrow night. We want Gran and Granda and Da, Shannon and Liam all here.
I squeal, jump from my chair, and rush around to hug them both.
Congratulations! How far along are you? When's the baby due?
Eva shakes her head.
Oh, I'm not pregnant.
I frown and look at Dylan's belly, confused.
Does it work differently with angels? Are you pregnant?
Dylan's eyebrows pop.
You think Eva got me pregnant? Are you sure being in that coma didn't crack your foundation?
I step back, totally confused.
Then if neither of you is pregnant,
you're adopting?
Kevin guesses.
Dylan frowns. I'm not telling you. We want to announce things tomorrow night when everyone's here.
I scoff. You're not seriously going to make us wait, are you?
You can tell us, and we'll all act surprised tomorrow.
Dylan shakes his head.
Nope.
Emmett whips an oven mitt at Dylan's head.
Seriously, dude? That's cruel.
He shrugs.
Blame Fee. We weren't the ones who brought it up. That was all her.
All the frustrated gazes turn to me.
Rude? Just because I'm extraordinarily sensitive to reading people shouldn't mean I'm punished for it.
Eva chuckles.
You're not being punished, Fee. There are a couple of things we want to get together before we spill our tea.
You don't have a tea, Auntie Eva.
Jackson absently remarks.
How can you spill it?
Dylan makes eyes at me and I sigh. Fine, you handle your announcement your way. I'll be over here decorating cookies and minding my business. Emmett laughs and reclaims his oven mitt.
Are we placing bets on how long she'll last before she starts in on them again?
I'll take 2 hours,
Aiden responds.
I'm thinking 5,
Brenny interjects.
14,
Dylan adds.
I think she'll be asking by breakfast coffee.
Callum pulls out his phone and starts taking down all their estimations. Kevin chimes in.
What are the stakes?
I roll my eyes. Har har, you're all so funny. Chapter 2.
Happy Yule, Miss Red.
Nikon snaps in with an easy smile and Sarah at his side. He leans in for a hug and kisses my cheek before stepping back so I can hug Sarah next.
Happy Yule, Miss Sarah. You look amazing.
The White Witch is wearing a silver sheath dress with a burgundy velvet ribbon tying back her long blonde hair.
You look like a beautifully wrapped present.
She laughs.
That's what Nikon said, too.
Nikon chuckles.
No, I said you looked beautiful and I want to unwrap you.
She rolls her eyes and blushes, but doesn't seem to mind the oversharing.
Hey, I'm not sure if you're aware, but Emmett invited Ciara for the evening. I know the two of you have had words in the past, and I don't want you blindsided if she comes.
Sarah's smile tightens, but stays in place.
Aye, he talked to me before he invited her. It's fine. I don't much like the woman, but it's been almost 2 years, and we've both moved on. I wish your brother nothing but happiness.
He feels the same way about you,
Nikon replies. She slides her hand around Nikon's back and snuggles in.
Aye, and I appreciate that.
Sloan comes over with two flutes of champagne in each hand and gets us all set up for our rounds.
Happy holidays to you both.
Thanks, Irish.
Nikon raises his glass to clink with Sloan's.
Here's to the end of a trying year.
Aye, I'll drink to that.
Over Sarah's shoulder, I see Emmett and Ciara standing out on the balcony, watching the dragons fly. After I excuse myself, I head outside to join them and say hello.
Happy holidays, Ciara. You look as stunning as always.
She does. Since the first day I met her, and after living with her and seeing her on her bad days, I can honestly say Ciara hasn't had a bad hair day, or a blemish, or worn an outfit that doesn't turn heads. It's sickening, actually. It was a huge hit to my ego at first, knowing she and Sloan used to work off energy together. I got over it soon enough. Then I hated the idea of her being with Emmett. I'd only seen her selfish and vindictive side. She's different with Emmett. It's obvious the two of them still love one another, so I hope for their sakes they can work through the roadblocks in their relationship.
It's good to see you on your feet, V,
Ciara says. You look much better than the last time I saw you.
Emmett nods.
Ciara was here for Thanksgiving and spent some time with you.
I'm not really sure how to respond to that.
Thanks for giving a shit,
she chuckles.
It took a while for us to get there, but I honestly want the best for both of you.
Sloan presses against my back, and his arm wraps around my ribs.
I think it's safe to say we've all grown and changed a great deal over the past 2.5 years. I'm thankful we found our way to this place.
Aye, me too.
Ciara raises her glass and winks at my brother.
Yeah, me too.
Emmett agrees. I catch the warmth passing between them and wonder if this is what Emmett meant about having set a plan in motion. Has he asked Ciara for a second chance at being together? They never ended because of a lack of love. Ciara didn't want to stay trapped on this island. She's a city girl and loves her friends and her family. With the city of Isilon repopulating and our portal gates allowing travel for our family, the world has opened up. Maybe it's enough for them to make it work. I want so much to bring it up and give them a push, but Emmett's right. I need to be patient and let the future unfold as it is supposed to. My stomach growls and I glance at my half-empty glass. I'm going to grab something to eat before the champagne takes hold.
Oy, we better do that sooner rather than later.
Sloan turns me toward the open glass wall.
We don't want you passing out or making a fool of yourself.
Emmett snorts.
Says you, Irish. Drunk Fee is hilarious.
I chuckle and let Sloan pull me inside. Drunk Fee will not be making an appearance. I'm married and mature now. Sloan grins.
Wasn't it this afternoon that you were setting out the onesie costumes for a movie marathon with a Greek?
I chuckle. What? A girl can't dress up like a giraffe and still be mature? His eyebrows pop.
Not usually, no.
Rude. I leave him chuckling in my wake and head over to the table to do some hunting and gathering.
I can't believe you haven't blown the blood vessels in your eye or had an aneurysm, baby girl.
I roll my eyes at Dylan and continue to stuff my face with shrimp.
I'm not talking to you.
He chuckles.
Don't be like that. You survived the not knowing, and once everyone gets here and the party is rocking, we'll fess up. Be happy for me.
The pleading look he pegs me with hits me right in the feels, and I crumble.
Of course I'm happy for you. I love you both, and whatever is going on, you two deserve only the most amazing things in life.
I finish organizing the presents under the tree and lift a hand for him to pull me to my feet. When he does, I wrap him in a hug and kiss his cheek. Happy Yulemas, big brother. Happy Yulemas, little sister. He squeezes me tighter, and a shadow of the haunted worry he's been carrying all week clouds his gaze. It only lasts a moment before it dissolves. Sloan and Emmett both said how shaken Dylan was by my comatose state. He's been quiet and slow to come around, but I've made it a point to be near him and give him plenty of hugs. Sure, he's our grouch, but underneath the crusty exoskeleton is a gooey center. A surge of magical energy charges the atmosphere of the cool condo, and Dionysus appears with Jonah at his side. Red sacks filled with presents weigh them down.
Hello, family. Let the festivities begin. The god of wine, feasts, and good times has arrived.
I leave Dylan to rush over and hug my sweet Greek.
Oh, I've missed you, Tarzan. I'm glad you're here.
Dionysus cants his head to the side.
Is everything all right, Jen?
Perfectly. I just missed your face.
He sets his sacks of presents down and hugs me, swinging my feet off the floor.
I missed your face, too. It's good to see you up and about again.
I've repeatedly heard the same comments from my family over the past week. When my feet are back on the rich hardwood floor, I turn to greet Jonah. Dionysus' boyfriend still holds the warm golden tan of his Texas cowboy roots, but looks more relaxed than I've ever seen him.
Congratulations. I heard you're taking a sabbatical from work and spending time living with Dionysus in his loft.
Jonah casts a warm gaze at Tarzan, and my heart thumps harder on their behalf.
It's been a magical 4 months.
I hug Jonah. We're so happy for both of you. Welcome to your first Clan Cool celebration.
It's a pleasure to be here with y'all.
Easing back from our hug, I hold his hands and smile.
Your new life looks good on you, cowboy.
Giddy up.
Dionysus waggles his brows.
I told him that earlier, but he said that was the sex talking. See, Jane thinks so, too, and you haven't had sex with her.
Jonah's cheeks flush red.
No, that's true.
I wave away his embarrassment.
Don't get fazed by anything Dionysus says in front of us. I promise you, we've heard and seen it all. Nothing would shock us.
Dionysus bursts out laughing and waggles his chestnut brows.
Challenge accepted, Jin. Oh, shite, love. What have you unleashed upon us this time?
Sloan greets Jonah with a handshake and moves to do the same with Dionysus. Of course, Dionysus ignores the outstretched palm and pulls my hubby in for a full embrace.
Happy holidays, Irish. While I know you already got your Yulemas miracle when Fee opened her eyes, I have a very special gift for you.
He reaches into his Santa sack and pulls out a small, flat box. Sloan accepts the wrapped box and looks at him.
Shall I put it under the tree to open later with the others?
Dionysus shakes his head.
No, open it right now. Trust me, it's exactly the gift you need after what happened with Fee.
Sloan looks at me, and I see the nervous trepidation in his gaze. I shrug. I have no idea what it is. After pulling the wrapping free from the box, Sloan eases the lid off and reveals an antique pocket watch. He stills, then carefully lifts the round body of the engraved gold timepiece out of its velvety black case.
It's incredible, Greek. I'm touched. It's remarkable.
It is. It's small and smooth. And the gold on the watch and the chain is aged and tarnished to the point where it's almost black. It's beautiful. Dionysus eases in and points.
It's a 16th century hunter case. Very old. Very rare. I enchanted it for durability because I want you to wear it. You always dress to impress, so having a pocket chain will only add class.
Sloan plunges the button on the top, and the front of the case flips open. The face of the watch is cream and simple, with easy-to-read black numbers. The hands are black and ticking around the face, keeping perfect time.
He closes the case and turns it over in his palm, caressing the back.
It's lovely, Greek, but I don't understand.
It's a double case. Open the back and you'll see your real present.
He caresses the smooth back of the watch and holds it up to examine the seams running along the side. There's a tiny lip, and he uses his fingernail to open the back case. Cupped in his palm as it is, I don't see what's inside, but I know there's something because Sloan exhales an unsteady breath.
Huppa what?
His ragged inhale is just as rough, and when I lean in to look at him, Sloan's eyes are glassed up, and tears are silently escaping. I've felt how close to the surface his emotions have been since I woke up, but it hurts to see him brought to tears.
What is it, Hotness?
Sloan shifts his shaky hand to show me the picture tucked into the back cover of the watch. Like the pocket watches of old, it holds a precious picture, but this one is more precious than most. The image of Sloan and I shows us standing in front of a stone building, his hand on my hip, his lips pressed against my temple. I'm staring off at something in the distance and smiling. Even so, there's no mistaking how in love we still are. I search Dionysus's smile and examine the picture again. Is this really us?
Yes, the two of you at the turn of the next century.
Damn, Tarzan. I look good for 100, and Hotness, you still rock my world. Look at how sexy you are.
The beauty of dragon longevity,
Dionysus remarks. Sloan meets Dionysus's gaze and pulls him in, holding him in a solid embrace. It isn't one of their manly back-pat hugs. This is a genuine embrace. While the entire gift is interesting and thoughtful, I'm missing a fundamental piece of this puzzle. At the risk of being the only person not understanding, can someone let me in on the emotional bonding? Sloan pulls back and studies the picture once more before he wipes his thumb under his eyes.
While you were cursed, well, I grew despondent as weeks turned to months. Dionysus, as he does, tried to cheer me up. He promised me you would wake up and we would grow old together, living long, full lives filled with family and laughter.
He told me to prove it.
Dionysus gestures at the watch.
Wear it in good health, my friend. When life turns on fee, as we all know it will, take strength in the knowledge that you will find a way through. It will all work out. You have an entire lifetime ahead of you.
Sloan goes in for another hug and kisses Dionysus' cheek.
I don't say it often enough, Greek, but I love you and value your place in our lives.
Dionysus' grin is brilliant.
It's true you don't say it often enough, but I know it.
I chuckle and pull him in for a hug. I say it all the time, so maybe it's getting old.
It never gets old, Jin. Go ahead, tell me again.
I kiss his cheek. I agape you, Tarzan.
Good, because I agape you right back.
Chapter 3. Dionysus and I are crawling under the tree and tucking his presents into position when Nikon arrives with Gran, Granda, Da, Shannon, and Liam. Everyone draws closer for holiday hugs, and the noise of the celebration doubles. Da looks at the overflow of gifts, and his eyes widen.
Did someone forget the rules of holiday gift giving?
I chuckle. I don't think Dionysus cares about the rules, Da. Da looks at him, and his gaze softens.
The holidays are about family and filling our emotional cups, son. We only buy for the kids and maybe a wee token or two for the others if we find something that moves us.
Tarzan nods.
Fee told me, but last year we were stuck in the darkness of the culling and Sloan was unconscious, so the celebration was sedate. Fee has just returned to us this year and I felt moved to celebrate. I promise commercialism doesn't suck me in. Every gift is something that I thought about and wanted to give.
Da nods in acquiescence.
Aye, all right. Just remember we invest our love in the people around us, not the things.
Trust me, I've worked on the perfect gift for months. They all qualify by the family rules. These aren't gifts, or at least not really.
He gestures at the wrapped presents still in his red sacks.
This is a game. It's Jonah's family tradition, and I thought it sounded fun, so we're going to play it later.
I loop my arm through Tarzan's elbow and pull him down to kiss his cheek. Well, we love games.
I know, that's why I thought it would be fun.
Da smiles at Jonah and offers him his hand.
We are happy to incorporate your family fun with ours. Welcome, son.
Gran takes that opportunity to follow my lead.
Happy holidays, my dear boy. I brought you something special.
She turns to Granda and takes the cake carrier from him.
I know how much you loved my banana coconut cake with the vanilla buttercream icing from the wedding, so I thought you might like one of your own to take home to share with your man.
Tarzan's eyes widen, and he looks from the cake carrier to Jonah and back again.
Thank you, Gran. It's perfect.
He takes the container, carefully passes it to Jonah to hold, and hugs Gran. She winks at me as she runs her hand up and down his back. Yeah, we're both very aware of how much extra love he needs to make up for the rejection and heartache he suffered. To some people, he's a strong and dangerous god who cares little about the lives of strangers. To those of us who take the time to know him, nothing could be further from the truth. Gran pats his chest and fixes his shirt collar when she eases back.
Now be a good lad and pop that home to put it into the fridge for later.
Yes, Gran.
Tarzan kisses her cheek, reclaims his cake, and snaps out. That leaves me to introduce Jonah to the family.
What are your plans for your family this season, son?
Da asks.
Will you take Dionysus home with you?
I hear the worry in his question and wonder if he's concerned on behalf of Dionysus or Jonah's family.
No, I only have a sister, and we haven't been close for many years. Dionysus and I will celebrate here with all y'all and have a small celebration with the two of us at the loft at some point.
That hurts my heart. Jonah has been navigating this world alone. I hug his arm and rest my head on his shoulder.
I'm glad we found you.
I am too, Fee, more than I can say.
The elevator door opens, and the rest of the family arrives. Callum and Kev arrive with Busy. Kinu and Aiden come in carrying the twins, and Meg and Jackson race past them, running ahead.
Maggie Jackson!
Dionysus is back and is all about the kids. I smile and catch the warmth in Jonah's eyes. He's a very special soul.
Jonah nods. That's for damn sure.
A high-pitched ting-ting-ting catches our attention, and we all turn to where Dylan and Eva are standing next to the decorated tree.
Can we get everyone's attention, please?
My heart patters excitedly in my chest as I reach for Sloan, and we all turn toward my brother and his angel.
It came up in conversation yesterday that Eva and I have an announcement we want to make, but we wanted to wait until everyone was here. Fee wrongly guessed that we were pregnant. We're not, but we are going to be parents.
Eva's wide grin is dimpling her cheeks.
It's a little different for angels. We aren't born of a man and a woman like humans are. We are brought from the heavens and placed.
By the stork,
Dylan chuckles.
You know how they say there's a little truth in all things? Well, I learned that the stork bringing babies is real. It's not just a human realm thing.
Eva nods. Dylan and I put our name in for a family placement, and we've been approved. That's the biggest reason we moved here to the island. Our children will be angels and therefore can't grow up in the human realm. Dylan can't live with the choir of angels, so living here on Isilon was the perfect solution.
Emmett presses a hand over his chest and smiles. We are so freaking happy to have you. I can't even tell you. And to be the answer to your baby needs? Man, it doesn't get much better than that.
Emmett and Brenny both hug Dylan and Eva. When they step back, Brenny asks,
when are we expecting our stork delivery?
Eva grins.
He'll be arriving anytime. His name is Haniel, and he was born into the designation of Reaper.
Haniel,
Gran repeats.
Och, it's a lovely name.
Of course, I'm calling him Han,
Dylan adds. Eva rolls her eyes.
Angels are supposed to be known by their full given names. He will be called Haniel.
If you say so.
Dylan obviously has no intention of following that rule. Da raises a finger to speak.
Congratulations. I'm pleased and proud the two of you are taking this on. You'll be wonderful parents. I have no doubt about that.
But Dylan stiffens and all his guards are readying to snap into place.
It's not a but, son. My question is, with Eva's term of the child being placed with you, will he be your son? Will he stay with you, with us? Is it a long-term placement or something less permanent?
Eva strokes a hand up Dylan's forearm and he relaxes a little.
He will be our son until he is called to his designation when he turns 17. In the heavens, that would come very quickly, but here, the time will pass the same as it does in the realm of man.
He'll be ours, da.
Dylan's tone holds an edge that wasn't there before.
That's all I wanted to know, son. We've seen how twisted up things can get with the choir. I wanted to be sure the two of you wouldn't put your heart and soul into loving him and they take him back.
Eva pats Dylan's arm. It's a fair question. Stop scowling at your father.
Agreed. I rush over to be the first to hug them. This is an amazing moment. Turn that frown upside down, big brother. You're going to have a baby.
Dylan must not have realized he's being quite so aggressive, because when Eva brings his attention to his behavior, he reins it in.
Sorry, da. Don't be. It's an emotional time for you both. You don't want anyone shadowing your decision. I get that. But whether you're 8 or 28, you're my son and I worry about you.
Dylan steps in and hugs Da.
I can only hope to be half the father you were with us. Seriously, there's not a thing I would change about the way you raised us.
Da eases back from their hug and cups Dylan's jaw in both hands.
That's generous praise. I hope it's true.
It is. Not one of the six of us has any beef with how Da raised us.
Excellent. More to celebrate.
Gran hurries over to hug Eva.
Congratulations to you both.
The celebration's energy shifts from the holidays to the impending arrival of our baby angel.
What do you think, Jen?
Tarzan asks a little later.
Does all this talk about the babies make you want to jump on the baby train?
Nope, not yet. I'm 25, my life is chaotic, and I have all the babies I need in my immediate family. I get all the benefit of wonderment and giggles and can hand them back at the end of the day.
Hells yeah!
Brenny raises his fist for a bump as he walks by.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.